topic, doctor-patient relationship. And why doctor-patient relationship? Because in olden era, a doctor was one of the family member of the locality, of the society. But now what is happening every day there is violence. Yesterday it is Sadarjang, another day it may be another Ambedkar hospital, the next day it may be GTB hospital. And why it is happening like this? So we need to review what is what has gone wrong in last, say, maybe not more than 20 years, because when we were doing MS and MBBS in the 80s, and there was no violence actually, and there was so much of communication, and then there was family clinics, then the family doctors who were interacting with the patients like a family member, and therefore that communication led to zero violence. And somewhere what has gone wrong, I'll try to come up with some solutions and some suggestions and what is doctor-patient communication. Because the nature of the relationship determines the success of treatment or intervention. Because it is not only the medicine, you must all remember, there may be lots of doctors here I suppose. And even if they are non-doctors, at one time or other they may be patient. So the treatment result will depend on what kind of relationship a doctor has with his patient. If you have better relationship with the patient, the results is likely to be better. So what is illness? Illness is just a social deviance where it impairs a normal role performance. Like I'm, like somebody says I am a CEO of some things, somebody else is CEO of something. So if I am ill, I'll not be able to do my job properly. And it affects smooth functioning of the society as well. It doesn't affect you only, it affects the society as well. And the amount of illness is controlled by socially prescribed roles for doctors and patients. In this case, the doctors become healer and the patient become a patient. Next. The communication which were initially, previously, it was like paternalistic. What was that traditional doctor-patient relationship? The doctor takes on the role of the parent and the patient is submissive, and then presently it is shifting towards mutuality. So what is mutuality? Now herein, in the present day circumstances, the doctor and patient are equal partner. They are two individuals, like I say, they are two experts, they are two individuals, doctor and patients. This is not like doctor acts as a parent or paternalistic. And kind of joint venture, and this is exchange of idea. Because I tell you something, you accept this or you understand this, then only you will say whether you trust a doctor or you don't trust a doctor. Yes. Then what is the consultation in this? It is mutual. This is less authoritarian, encourages patient to their own feelings and concerns, and there are open questioning that opens up a vast area of interest in the psychosocial aspect of the illness. Because I always say it is not only the physical aspects, it is the social aspects, it is psychological aspects. Health is considers four things, that is social, psychological, spiritual and physical. So in all these, it has to be taken care of when doctor initiated treatment. And the voice of patient, communication of patient beliefs, feelings and psychosocial context are very, very important. Next. Then, presently what is happening is, now it is becoming more and more consumerist, where the doctor is actually passive and patient takes an active role, and because they come to the doctors for second opinion, referral from other hospitals, and they come with a case summary, transfer summary, sick summary, and then they think that, doctor, look, you are paid to do what I tell you. This is the worst scenario, what is going on in the present. And then they come with lots of internet knowledge, and which is very, very harmful, I would warn you. Next. So then comes a default where patient adopts a passive role and doctor reduces its control. And if patient is not aware of alternatives to passive patient role, and or he is timid in adopting a participative relationship, then it becomes by default. Next. So then there are a few other models, especially in seriously ill patient, when the patient cannot be, patient has to be told, or their attendants has to be told that, look, this has to be done. Then they need to understand that this is known as activity passivity model. Especially in cases of acute diseases, then we need to guide and cooperate with them, and the chronic diseases, mutual participation model. Next. So what are the other factors which influence it? Like in a government hospital, like Jain Saab just told you that there is clinic in Mohalla clinic, but in the hospitals what is happening? There's lots and lots of rush. The doctors give very, very little time because one doctor has to see say 200, 300 patients in 2 hours time. So obviously there is a shortage of time that leads to miscommunication, less communication or no communication. Ideally, it should be average 6 minutes. If it is less, there may be problem of miscommunication. And it is why it is less? Because the pressure of time on doctors and then also the doctor's own style and approach influences then the time available. And then it needs to be patient-centric approach and needs more time. But it overall reduces the number of return visits, thus the total consultation time actually is reduced. Next. So if first time a doctor gives more time, next time possibly he will not have to give more time, like 6 minutes, he may be okay in 1 minute. Then there are other influences on doctor-patient relationship. Then there is one person that is patient. And what is his ability to exercise and control depends on age, social education level, male, female, genders or children, different languages, and whether it is a member of an ethnic minority. Next. Then, in general practice, in hospital situation, in ward or specialist practice, the doctor-patient relationship will be different. But like in a family clinic, he will like to listen more to the family doctor. He will like to know more about his family. Doctor may like to know more about his family, but in the consultation or in the ward situation, it may not be so. Next. So, how do we make a decision in a doctor-patient relationship? First, there is information exchange, which may be one way or two way, that is shared or one way. And then there is a deliberation. The deliberation is with patient and attendants. And then they decide on treatment to implement doctor and patient. So ideal would be shared with doctor, patient, and ideal would be having their relatives also with them. So this will reduce the burden on patient itself to decide. So there will be shared decision. Next. So how do we ensure that there is this shared decision and that miscommunication is less? Because there is increased medical knowledge among patients, prevailing social values, individual autonomy and responsibility, chronic illnesses, it is different. To make choices and to balance risk and benefits, doctors make inaccurate guesses. So this is just a busy slide, but only one thing I would say for making a shared decision, please have somebody, the patient needs to have somebody who he can confide, whether this can be his wife, his parents, and the doctor. And take your time, don't be in a hurry, say maybe 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 6 minutes, and then you, once you are satisfied, you will be cured of your illness, or it will take less time for the treatment. Next. So compliance is must. Like I say, you take this drug for 3 days, 8 hourly every day, morning, afternoon, evening. So compliance will be better when there is better understanding of doctor-patient relationship. And this has been found that the extent to which patient follows the clinical instructions of the physician, research confirmed that doctor-patient relationship is the best predictor of whether the patient will follow the doctor's instruction or not. And the example of compliance are like taking medication on schedule, keeping appointments, like he has been asked to come after 48 hours or after 1 week or 3 weeks, he does come back. The following direction for changes in behavior or diet, approximately 1/3 of patients are compliant with treatment, 1/3 complies some of the time and 1/3 do not comply of the treatment at all. And then thereafter, they say that this doctor is good or bad or treatment is bad. So it has to be both ways. Doctor also has to be a little more serious, little more communicative, and the patient also has to have a faith. The one key thing is, doctor, whatever doctor is doing, the patient has to have faith. I always say, if you do not have faith in your doctor, please don't go to that doctor. That treatment will never is not going to work. Next. So, what are the factors associated with decreased patient compliance? As I said, if perception of physician is rejecting and unfriendly, that physician is unfriendly, physician failure to explain the diagnosis or causes of symptoms which he perceives. But suppose doctor is in a hurry and does not explain or explain in a hurry, the patient may think that he has not he has failed to explain the diagnosis or causes of the symptoms. And increased complexity of treatment regimen and more than three types of medication taken more than four times a day, this also makes it more complicated. So what we try to do, minimum medications and minimum times, extended release tablets once a day, so that compliance would be better. There also, the physician enthusiasm, physician experience, the older the age, but maybe with the more and more skillful technology coming up, more and more younger doctors are being asked for short waiting room time. This is also very important. Then how much time he has to wait? Suppose he has to wait for 1 hour, 2 hours, he definitely will be impatient. And the patient knowledge of the expected positive treatment outcome, patient knowledge of names and effects of drugs, side effects, everything has to be told to the patient. Next. Next. Now coming on to the communication skill. Do you know how much is the communication is non-verbal? How much is non-verbal communication which affects your decision? It is more than 93%. Verbal communication is only 5 to 7%. So how do you communicate to the patient? This is also very important. That also enhances the patient-doctor relationship. Then first is content and then is the process. But how doctors say that, how the doctors ask question, how well he listens, how he sets up explanation, planning with patient, how he structures his interaction and makes that structure visible to the patient. Suppose you are sitting on a chair, doctor is sitting on his chair, and then he is talking on the phone, the patient will not be comfortable. They are absolutely there. So you need to be very, very cautious when you are talking to the patient, that you are serious, your intention should be like, is serious intent, you are focusing on what he is saying. If the doctor is writing what the patient is saying, so obviously patient will say that he is listening to me very, very seriously. This is a normal communication process. And the same thing is with the doctor-patient relationship. Next. So, what are the basic steps? Initiate a section, gather the information, building the relationship. Then explain and planning to provide the appropriate amount of type of information. And then finally the closing the session. See, this is all standard and that we all have to try. If there are young doctors here, everyone has to try. But I understand that in the government setup you may have more patients, you will not be able to do all this, but try to be at least empathetic. You need to show your serious intent, even if you are giving less time, but show them the serious intent. And then that is what the topic back to square one. You need to come to that level that, look, there are two persons involved, doctor and patient, and you need to be friendly, you need to be professional, both simultaneously. Next. So, advice, reassurance, support from the doctor can have a significant effect on recovery. This is also known as placebo effect. Like in ICU, this patient was multiple fractures, but if doctors tells him, look, on the upside, you are the healthiest patient in ICU. The other patient is on ventilator. So obviously, this will make him happy. Next. But their own values, their doctors or conflicts may be there. But in the end, interest of individual patient is supreme and the confidentiality is must. Next. So outcomes are clinical outcomes and satisfaction of doctor and patient. Next. So to conclude, the doctor-patient relationship is at the core of practice of the healthcare, that you all know. The essential for the delivery of high-quality healthcare in diagnosis and treatment of disease, the doctor-patient relationship itself is a part of therapeutic process. I am again emphasizing again and again. Many issues may complicate or negatively affect the doctor-patient relationship if not taken properly into consideration. Next. And as in the end, John Bernard Shaw has said, we have not lost faith, but we have transferred it from God to the medical profession. What I am saying in the end is, the patients also need to think doctors as human beings only, that's all. And doctors also try to become good human beings from our side. This is what we have to square one. This is person-to-person interaction, no more paternalistic attitude, it has to be mutuality, shared decision-making, and then possibly we are going back to square one when we started, when we were doing MBBS in 70s and 80s. Thank you very much.